You can.
You can.
Right.
Where were we?
Ow.
Okay.
Water in my eye. Sex, Luxari, and Luxask. Okay. In the last episode, we were trying to understand this basic chart, well, blank chart, in the D3 Getting Started docs, and we quickly got stuck and confused on d3.scaleLinear. And we decided that d3.scaleLinear, that's what we should stop and explore in the next episode. And that is this episode. So, let's think for a minute what scale is, conceptually, in life. Let's see if I have a good example. Yeah, here. It's ours. This house is very tiny. I bought it at a miniature fair in Stockholm. Super cool. I think that this is scale 1 to 500 or something like that. 500 to 1. I don't know science. I'm teaching this. This is YouTube. In most real-world scenarios, we can think of scale as a mapping of real value to a scaled value. So a real house would be like, I don't know, 7.5 meters high, maybe. And the equivalent miniature, in this case, is like 1.5 centimeters. And if you're wondering what 7.5 meters is translated to furlongs or barley corn, you just go away, you imperialist. None of this would have happened if Gustav II just did his fucking job. But I digress. If we talk about this little house example in D3 terminology, 7.5 meters, that's the actual real world value, which in D3 terminology can be thought of as the input domain of the scale, and the 1.5 centimeters is on the output range of the scale. So I repeat that values is an input domain mapped to values on an output range. In on the domain, out on the range. So we usually scale up or down. Scale, the word actually comes from the Latin scala, which translates to ladder or staircase. And this miniature and the, say, something like the scale of a map of a city, that's rather straightforward to understand. But scaling can actually get pretty weird. So just to make you relive the minor trauma from the last episode, let me remind you that it was our encounter with scale UTC, a temporal scale, that led us to learn about scale linear first. We won't get into scale UTC until later, but just to think a little bit about scales from a more generalized perspective, the usage of scale UTC on the x-axis here is a case where we want to map a domain of time to a range of pixels. So, just like this house goes from big to small, sometimes we want to have time go to pixels, or in another case, we might want to scale temperature to a color so that it will become more red the warmer it is and blue when it gets colder. And if you are unclear on what the freezing point of water is, it's 0 degrees. So that's all rather abstract and big, so let's get practical and small. I'm going to start by calling d3.scaleLinear, just this little function in the simplest ways possible to just get comfortable with it. In Swedish, we have a great expression called fingerfärdig, which translates roughly to finger skilled or finger adept. And we're just trying to get used to this thing. And that's kind of principle three with this series, nerding out on discomfort until it becomes comfort. So when something is overwhelming, we just nerd out on it until it stops being overwhelming. So there is a subtle distinction here. We're not breaking down things into small parts in order to, you know, make progress. we're breaking things down to become more comfortable with D3. Yes, there will be progress, but that's not the objective. The objective is comfort. So anyway, what d3.scaleLinear does is that it creates a function, it returns a function that you in turn can call. It's a scaling function. In its default state, the scale is just 1 to 1. So it doesn't really do anything, or almost nothing. It's basically the identity function in functional programming, if you're familiar with it. So you see here on line 5 that it's outputting 1, 2, 3, which is the same value that we are calling it with on line 4. So it's a 1-to-1 scale. So calling scale linear directly is, I believe, the same as asking for a domain that goes from 0 to 1 and a range that also goes from 0 to 1. 0, comma, 1. Oh, yeah, that should be an array. And yeah, that's a 1-to-1 scale. So when we are calling scale linear without specifying a domain or range, it's implied that we want range and or domain to go from 0 to 1. Okay, so let's think about a little house here that is 1.5 centimeters high, and the actual domain of the house is 7.5 meters. So that means if I say that it's a house that is 3 meters high, that means that the range is 40% of that scale. You see here? Does that make sense? If you're confused, your confusion might be valuable, so please share it in the comments below, and it might spark a good follow-up episode, or somebody will help you. Never stay confused alone. That is unnecessary and it sucks. Anyway, so if I put in 0 meters here, then it returns 0. And if I say that we are at 7.5, then it returns 100% or 1. And if I give it 8, then it returns 106%. So let's say that I want the domain of the house scale to go from 0 to 7.5 meters. And I want the range of the miniature to go to 0 to 1.5 centimeters. It is a scale of 1 to 500. Then that should be 7.5 divided by 500. And oops, again, I forget those methods, once array arguments. There. That is 0.015 meters, which is 1.5 centimeters, which is smart. I don't know. Does that make sense to you? I hope it makes sense. That makes sense to me. So let's go back and try to understand the original code in the getting started docs here. And recall that it is the Y scale here on the left that we are concerned with right now. First, there's a bunch of chart dimensions and margins here that declare how big the pixel area is, the canvas. And with those in mind, we can start to understand here what we're looking at on the declaration of the y-axis. We're creating a linear scale for the y-axis, the domain, the input values of that set, the input values that we are eventually going to be feeding it from our data set, whatever that may be. What we do know here is that we expect those values to span from 0 to 100 because, well, that's the input domain that is being defined here. However, that's not what we're going to be drawing to the screen, because we want to map transform values in that domain to a range of pixels. And those pixels are going to need to start at the very bottom of the canvas, or rather the bottom of the canvas minus the margin bottom, and then span to the top of the canvas, or rather top of the canvas minus the margin top. And notice here that range is actually inverted. Mathematically, it goes from a high value to a low value, because you want the output range to be like a thermometer, higher values upwards. But the y-axis on an SVG canvas and most graphic drawing things, it goes the other way. So like the higher the y value, the lower you are. And depending on how much experience you have with graphics, that might hurt your head a little bit. It hurts mine a bit. But I'm mentioning it because it's important, because it really hints at the essence of what we actually use D3 for, what D3 is. It's a library for taking data and putting it through these transformation widgety things that allows us to take a string of numbers and make it into a set of coordinates or values that make sense, graphically speaking. Percent to pixels, temperature to color, that kind of thing. Right, so that's d3.scaleLinear. How do you feel? How do you feel? Was anything that confused you, or a reflection, something that you guys got, oh, my brain got, wah? Like, drop it in the comments, and we'll decide a little bit if this needs a follow-up episode where we clarify some things or nerd out a little bit more, or maybe we are ready to go back and tackle d3.scaleUTC. Now that we are wise to linear scales. If you're watching this from the future, you will know that we went ahead and did this because that video is there. Or you might just want to take a little bit of a break from D3 and look at this video.